waste.
I can recall very clearly my first sight of Robert Forster. We were at that stage doing a drama course towards a Bachelor of Arts degree at the University of Queensland. And I actually remember seeing Robert in a version of Rocky Horror Show.
Really?
And he was actually, I think my memory serves me well, was in, I'm not going to say a nappy, but Sebastian, that kind of like the body with some sort of loincloth thing.
Yes,
a loincloth. I don't know what they were into, but we were doing a very bad version of Hamlet, and they were doing the Rocky Horror Show. But I remember Robert was tall, and then in the next semester we got to be in the same group, and I would see Robert then, remembering him bringing in records and magazines, which I was also reading and listening to, and we started talking.
The drama department was very good at university at that time because it was off campus. It was at the Avalon Theatre. Mm-hmm. And it was really good for me because, you know, like I wasn't doing very well, and it was like a physical thing off campus. And also it sort of extracted all the weirdos from the arts department, seemed to drift towards the drama department, and like it was a lot looser, and it was a lot, you only had to turn up basically to pass, you know, and I was turning up to a lot of other things and failing.
You still had to.
So like the fact that, and it was fun, it was good fun. I was in a band and we only played three shows over 2 years, like 76, 77. The band was called The Goddos, but it was very atypical for the time, you know, like it was more sort of, you know, like beat groupy and poppy. Our drummer was the head boy at Mount Gravatt High. Mm-hmm. And so we used to rehearse in Mount Gravatt High, and because he had a key into the building. I mean, so we played his Christmas party, and then we played the 1977 Academy of Music Rock.
In Search of a Band.
In Search of a Band. And so that was our last performance. And so that had been going for about 2 years. But we'd sort of rehearse and never play, but we're rehearsing. And at the end of it, I started to write songs. And it got to the stage where I realised that I could never play with anyone, that I had to teach someone. And also I realised that the songs I was writing, like I just started like writing Karen and writing other songs like Eight Pictures. And I realised that the sound was probably going to be a three-piece. So, and I always thought drummers, you know, like we could get to that second. What I need is someone to play the bass to my guitar chords. And like the songs like Karen and Lee Remick, you know, like a three notes, three chords. So I thought that if I could find someone and teach them, it'd be better than these dead ends that I was, you know, like, because no one else was on the same wavelength. And so, but it also coincided, you know, like with actually meeting someone, Grant, who I could talk music to as well. So the idea of teaching someone, but also teaching someone that I knew really well, I thought was fantastic, and we got on really well. Was, you know, so once, you know, like Grant was there, then you know, like, then the band was there, like the start.
I just want some affection. I just want some affection. I don't want no hoochie coochie mama, no back door. Sex thing. I want a tiger on bended knees with all the kindness of the Japanese. I just want some affection. Wish I heard voices. Wish I was a telephone.
we had many huge kind of dreams at that time as well. It wasn't just the band. That's the thing. Once I kind of agreed to play bass with Robert, initially I said no, because I was living on a cattle station at that time, and I was finishing the degree, and I thought I was going to be a film writer or a writer or something. And we decided to kind of start the band. And the other things we had in mind were, you know, a magazine. You know, we started writing a film. We wanted to do The Factory in Brisbane. You know, so it was kind of like, it was a whole scene thing we wanted going. And that's why Brisbane, in a way, it never quite lived up to my imagination, because it was always music in general, which was a harder, faster kind of music to what we did.
The group was really successful right from the word go. I mean, the first time we got on stage, the first time we played, we were extraordinarily impressive. And when we played in Brisbane, we were good, you know, and we were appreciated. And so, like, the other things that we're thinking of doing, like, the group was like, you know, you can sit around and talk, and then, you know, like, we go out and play, and there'd be 200-300 people, you know, clapping, dancing. We'd be meeting lots of people, and it was just, like, this seemed like the group took over. Like, the group became the thing. I mean, we'd get up and play Lee Remick and Karen, and we'd have other songs just as good. Single got out, and so when we went around the world, people actually knew that single, although only, you know, like 500 of them were ever made.
At the time, most of the music we were listening to, I'd say 85% of it was American music, and I always have wondered, like you mentioned hindsight, why in November of 1979 we, Robert and I, decided to go to England after two singles, and basically just see what we could do with those two records.
But, you know, like, we were right from the start going to be worldwide, and so we didn't want to go down and waste 3 years trying to conquer another town. You conquer one town and then you go for the world championship, you know. And that's what we, and you know, like, it was either New York or London. We went to London. Lee Remick was played on John Peel, and so, you know, Orange Juice and Alan Horn, who were just doing the label, they approached us, and because Grant and I were in London at the time. This is like January 1980, we're in London, and like, we went over there knowing no one in the whole music business, and we didn't really get all that far. It's a sheer miracle, but the only musical connection we could make, and it happened, was, you know, in Glasgow. And so, you know, like, we went up there, and immediately everything fell into place, you know, because we met a lot of like-minded people who were extraordinarily different to us, the postcard people, but we got on,
which was great, after the failure in London.
I look at you and I wonder why animals extinct, and I'm beginning to cry. Give me a bank book, and sometimes I think detectors, the child detective. Everything's brand new and it's all effective. So easy just to pretend.
in the meantime, Robert's gone back to Australia, and he's in Brisbane. I come back, and the last thing I said to Robert Forster, this is I always like this story, is just as he was leaving, I said, "Look, we'll just wait just a little while before I get back. I'll come back from New York, and we'll start, you know, rehearsing some new songs, and because you know we'd done the postcard single." I come back and Robert's already playing with other people because he was so excited, obviously, by the music that was going on in his heart and his head, and knowing that what we'd done was world class. We were kind of thinking, well, shall we go back to the original idea of getting a woman drummer? Lindy Morrison was playing in another Brisbane band at that stage. We knew her because it was a small scene. And so about July of 1980, July, August, I think, Lindy joined the group, and we rehearsed solidly for about, three months or something.
Yeah, we'd been together, like, with Lindy in the band for a year, just in Brisbane, you know, and working on material, and then we just went down to Melbourne to do the album with Tony Cohen, who was the sort of house engineer, I guess, for Missing Link, and we did the album in Richmond Recorders, just the three of us. We did do some other songs again, I think, and we did, and but we could have done an album, which is a profound regret of mine. We could have done an album if we had the money to do an album in 79, which was, you know, like us, by the time we left Brisbane in 79, we had a fantastic set, and we, you know, it was a really good, but it was a different style of music to what we were in 1981, very different. And so like this album, like to me, is like us at the very beginning. That's why it's good. But it's us not fully realised, and it's us. So the first album's almost just like, to me, some sort of documentary. And it sounds like it was done in a practice room in one day. And just, it's like a documentary of us going towards something.
I'd suspected for some time that you had other lovers. But I didn't know that those men in your room weren't really your brothers. And I was working in the ice rink. Spring and summer that year. And I remember some of those dates. Another still very clear. I shot you with my camera. Watch you doing things with him. I shot you with my camera. Watch you doing things with him. And you can't complain. You
has great values and great character. But it's, to me, it sounds like someone's pressed a tape recorder and gone, okay, well, play us your 10 songs or your 12 songs. And it's, you know, like, it's microphones in a warehouse type sound. But the sound of the record's very good. I mean, especially on songs where the songs are actually better, you know, where the songs actually hang together. Like something like It Could Be Anyone, Eight Pictures. Like, those two songs are my favourite too. And the other thing is, I mean, for a group as great as the Go-Betweens, what I like about, we don't start with the classic first album, do we?
It sounds more like a last album.
It does.
It sounds like a group breaking up.
Yeah.
More than a group sort of coming together.
We start with an album that sounds like we're breaking up. And then we go on to make five more albums.
Which...
It's a major thing. The major thing I think that happens in terms of one stroke of good luck that we had, and we had quite a few. The one was Rough Trade picking up Send Me a Lullaby. I think that was a really, because otherwise we would have been stuck in Melbourne and we were going downhill fast. And really, and we might have got out, but I don't know how and in what sort of shape, but. We were suddenly just picked up and deposited in London, supporting the birthday party on our first shows. The first summer in England, like that one of 82, when we came over, was the best summer that I ever spent in London. And it was like, it was good because we the group came over, and it was our second time back. You know, we'd done Postcode, and that sort of slipped, and we'd sort of gone back to Australia and just sort of reconstructed, and, you know, like got the whole thing back. And Rough Trade miraculously just sort of came through with a record deal, and it was like what we wanted, you know, someone going, we're a label, you know, they're very well known, they're very good, they pick great groups, and they, you know, like there's album budgets involved. And so, you know, like, we're just going, fantastic, you know. Another important fact of Before Hollywood was that we worked with a producer for the first time, John Brand, and he was a lot more of a perfectionist, and he brought a certain sort of classical approach to recording that was very good, and that he disciplined the band to an extent, right. but he still caught all the fire and all the angles and all the melody and all the beauty that we had. He caught it, and he really added to it. I always thought did a really great job and was really a very important part of it.
He was dedicated to the songs, which was... That's what struck me at the time. He genuinely liked the song.
Yeah, that was true. I remember him, you know, going away that first day, and then he came back a couple of days later and he said, you know, for a while he couldn't make any sense of it. And then he started to break down the songs and he realised that everything was fours and eight, was in a classical way, but he'd never heard it put together, or, you know, like with our angle, with our instruments and our sound and our lyrics. He was just completely bowled over, almost in non-comprehension. But he could sense something was going on. We haven't really done it with Send Me a Lullaby, but we know there's a classic album within the chemistry of the three people. And I think that's something that we felt very much at the time, that we'd sort of slightly muffed our chance at the start, but it's a very good album, Before Hollywood.
A beautiful record.
Mm.
It's there's a timelessness on it which strikes me every time I kind of listen to it. At the end of 82, early 83, Robert Vickers had heard the record.
Yeah.
He was loved it, absolutely loved it, and said, you know, he could hear, you know, what was going on musically. He said, "Well, I'd like to join the band," and we pretty much said yes. You know, like just immediately sent him a tape, and I moved on to lead guitar.
The dark sheep of the Go-Betweens album family.
Well, if that's the dark sheep of the Go-Betweens oeuvre, what would you call the first one?
I'd call that The Little Cousin.
I think it's The Family Freak Locked in the Attic, myself.
What, the first album?
Yeah.
No,
you know, people come around and, what's that noise up? Says, oh, that's...
That's the first album. No, it's childish to me, the first. It's a childish quality of the first record. The third album, Spring Hill Fair,